This is the group that needs insects as much as anything, our baby birds. And I say that with confidence because this is a list of the terrestrial bird families in North America that rear their young on insects, or the book will say other arthropods. And those other arthropods are the spiders that ate insects to become spiders. It's 96% of our terrestrial birds are rearing their young on insects. We are so used to thinking of insects as seed and berry eaters of birds. We're thinking of birds as seed and berry eaters that I can pick up any Landscape for Birds book, and that's what it'll talk about. How do you put bushes in your yard that makes berries? And that's fine, because the birds that stick around during the fall and winter do eat a lot of berries. But when they are making more birds, when they're reproducing, this is what they need. They need insects and spiders. And that happens to be a really important time in their life history. So I'm going to generalize and say that if this brown thrasher is in an area that does not have enough insects, that's the baby brown thrasher. It's not going to be able to rear its offspring through to maturity. And that's such an area. How much food do we need to make in our yards to keep our birds happy? The short answer is we don't really know, but we're starting to find out. And the answer is going to be lots. And who's telling me this? Our chickadees. My little chickadee family in my yard this summer told me this. And this is how they did it. They colonized my little house there. I set up my camera, and I just started to take pictures of what they were bringing back to the nest. It turned out 100% of what they brought back to the nest were caterpillars. It turned out that both the male and the female foraged for food for the babies. Of course, ornithologists already know this. And they do it, they're bringing back something about once every 3 minutes. So they're very busy. As a matter of fact, in a 27-minute period, they brought in 30 caterpillars. And that's because sometimes they bring in more than one. Sometimes they bring in a whole bunch. And they do this from 6 a.m. to 8 p.m. Got to put the 8 back up in there. In other words, they're doing it all day long. Sometimes the caterpillars are brown. Sometimes they're green. And all of these caterpillars are coming from trees in my yard. And I know that because these guys forage within 50 meters of their nest, a circle of 50 meters of the nest. So we've got about 300 caterpillars being delivered to these baby chickadees every single day. And they do that for 16 days. So if you do the math, that is 4,800 caterpillars required to bring one clutch of chickadees through. So does your yard make 4,800 caterpillars? I was amazed when I actually saw this. Now this is a typical tree in my yard. When we moved in, it had been mowed for hay, so there wasn't anything there. So this is a white oak that I have planted from an acorn. It's now 12 years old. I have collected caterpillars from that tree many times, and I can tell you on a really good day I might find 5. Well, let's say I'm lousy at it compared to the chickadee. Let's say the chickadee can find 25 when he looks at that tree. Well, that would mean I need 192 trees to produce 4,800 caterpillars. And remember, once they take the caterpillar away, it's gone. If you take all the caterpillars away on day one and on day two, they're still gone because caterpillars don't spontaneously appear. You know, the eggs have to hatch. They've got to develop. 192 trees. If each tree occupies 15 by 15 foot, space, that's an acre of trees to produce the caterpillars needed by one family of chickadees. So if we're trying to restore the ecological integrity of a suburban yard like this, it's not just the amount of plants that we need to think about. We certainly do have to get plants into that space. But the type of plant we put there becomes really important. You might think then the solution is simply to plant native plants and all will be well. But our research has also shown that not all native plants are equal in their ability to support food webs. So let's focus primarily on the ones that are really good at it, at least while we're trying to rebuild things. We want the biggest diversity we can get, but some plants are much better at supporting food webs than others. This is a ranking of the woody plants in the mid-Atlantic states. So that includes Pennsylvania. The little numbers after each plant genus, on the numbers of species of caterpillars, the number of species of bird food that each one of these genera can support. So memorize that. What are we going to do with this list? We're going to use it to compare any two plant genera in terms of their ability of supporting food webs. So let's take tulip tree. Liriodendron, tulip rifer, and compare it with one of the oaks, Quercus. We go to our list and we say oaks are number one. 534 species of Lepidoptera, of caterpillars, have been recorded using oaks in the mid-Atlantic states, compared to tulip tree supports 21 species. Now, these are both native tree species. They both belong in our forest. We're not going to wage war on tulip trees. But if you have, first of all, if you have a tulip tree monoculture, and they're really common where I come from, because we removed all the other trees, that's not so good. We could fix that. Or if you have a space in your yard that you could put one tree in, and you're trying to decide, which is it going to be? Are you going to choose a tulip tree? You're going to choose an oak. If one of your goals is to rebuild food webs, that's what we're thinking about here.